out of choices, but if you say yes, then I got to go forward with it. I think bonds are a wonderful idea, quite frankly, if we want to get some things done right now.
I apparently had a technical glitch, so could the next two speakers just quickly summarize, Don and Clint? I'm not sure I recorded that. I'd just like Don to repeat what he said, just a couple of sentences, and then Mr. Steiger to repeat what he said about bonds and stuff.
Bonds is something that is an option we all should consider, and it's one of many ideas.
Okay, thank you.
What I stated is I appreciate his input and suggestion, and I will try to see what possibilities are out there that I can maybe bring to the table. And also, I'd like to add, some of these suggestions that we're hearing tonight, I would like to see these people also bring these suggestions to a council meeting where we have a full council. We will be having a budget workshop on the 19th of this month, and I'm not sure where we will come from that, but I'd like to have some of these suggestions. There is a suggestion box in the hallway of State Hall. Go ahead and put those suggestions in that box for us. That way we can bring it to the entire council member. And I think some of these suggestions are excellent.
Thank you. Ms. Garberding, you're next.
Looking at the first of the year, we were talking about changing out all our meters here, water meters here in the city, with a bond with that. And that's going to help us in a lot of directions with the public works, because now you don't have two guys out on the truck reading meters. It can manually be done. It's also going to save money when we have issues with water shut off and turn on, those kinds of things. And it gets us out there looking at our water infrastructure as well and being able to do a better inventory when we're out there replacing those meters. So that's one of the things that's kind of on the works, and we're looking at probably moving that forward after the first of the year. The streets has always been a very concern of ours. It's like, try to rush for grant funding. There's just not a lot of money there for a street for the state and county and all of that. I mean, county wants us to take over some of their roads because they can't fix them. They're letting them go to gravel. You know, just like we can't fix them. Just like West Valley is a huge issue. But anyway, so those kind of things, trying to find those funding. There's also some talk, and you're going to be hearing this as we go through budget speeches, about forming a transportation benefit district. Some of you may know what that means, or maybe you don't. What that means is, by state law, the city is allowed to do this without going to the voters. The max is $40 per car tax. The city's not interested in $40. We're not interested in doing that to the people of our community. But we're looking at forming a transportation benefit district that will add $20 per car tab per year, and that money goes strictly into a fund to go dedicated strictly to streets. And so that's one of the things that we're looking at, and there will be a lot of conversation about that. And so I would encourage you to stay involved and pay attention. So if you have some concerns or some feedback that you would like to give on that, come and talk with the council and let them hear what you're thinking about that. Otherwise, we just don't know how we're going to find the money to fix the streets.
How would you capture money from all the people who are driving through Pacific and breaking down the streets, like the folks who get off of West Valley Highway and go through on Frontage Road and Valentine, or cut over to Skinner to get to Lakeland Hills? 50,000 cars a day or more. Has there been a consideration about the a toll?
I thought very seriously.
Yeah.
Those are Auburn citizens driving through our town. Anyway, so, but it is. It's Lakeland Hills coming down to the freeway, a lot of that traffic. And we joked around, how are we going to pay for that bridge? I'm sure you know that there is the last piece of the project for the Stewart Road project is from Valentine and including the bridge. Now, only from Valentine to View belongs to the City of Pacific. The rest of it belongs to Sumner. But we are partnering up with the City of Sumner to go after funding to finish that last piece of that road. So it's four lanes all the way down. And we joked around about we should put a toll on it so that they could pay for it, because the money's coming from us. You know, well, it's actually coming from the state. Most of that money we're going to pay is up getting from the state through the Transportation Improvement Board. They're very interested in finishing that project. So by partnering with them, we're more likely going to get the funding for that. But it includes the railroad, it's the bridge, it's the railroad, it's a lot of different pieces that are in place. So you're funding. I mean, West Valley, how do we fix West Valley? Where do we get the money for that? It's not even our road, most of it. It's King County.
While we're on roads, we can work back across. I'd like to interject a question. Pacific is in a Lahare zone, a flood zone, a high seismic zone. You know, the big earthquake is liable to happen. With the two King County roads coming down off the hill, folks in the valley will have difficulty getting out of the valley if there is a Lahare warning. I live on the hill. I'll watch y'all, and I'll pray for you. But what is the council, the current incumbents and the candidates' opinions of how to improve the Lahare escape route out of the valley for 6,000 Pacific residents?
That's a good question, Jean, and I've often joked that you'll be able to walk on top of the car to go up to a beach because it will be jam-packed. And this has come up a couple times. You and I have had conversations. I sat down with Senator Malosha probably about a month ago, and we had talked about King County owns the two one-ways that go up the hill and down the hill. And we talked about maybe even turning those into trails, working with Federal Way, the state, as well as the City of Pacific, King County, and to see if we can get funding, if anything, for them to be trails to go up the hill and down the fix them, and they just assume they stay closed. And I understand we're going to need a pass, you know, if something like that happens. I would encourage people to go the other way as well. You know, there's a four-lane road that's going to go out of the valley heading east. And so, but that is an issue.
You have to get across the river, though, to go east. And the river is where the volcanic mud flow will go.
It's that late, and it's too late anyway.
Okay.
I joke around, too, all the tilt-ups in Sumner is going to make it go right around Pacific if it bypasses.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Come on up.
And I guess just to kind of add this right on to that. All of our, I have a perception of nobody more cares about the White River anymore. Flooded out in 2009, like so many other people.
Could you stepped up the mic a little bit?
All our contacts are gone now. There's nobody at the county that we can talk to. All those people. Can you hear me now?
Let's see what we got here.
Try that.
I can hear it.
There
you
go.
Thanks. So all of our contacts are gone now, where we can get a status on the river. And I have the perception that nobody really cares anymore. They've forgotten about it. And so I'd like to know, in the future, what council members and the mayor, how they're going to work with King County. And I'm stepping around because you can walk down to that river right now, and the beavers have been real busy down there. And there are large stands of trees that are died and are falling over, and they're changing that river as we speak. There's been nobody down there. And, you know, to me, the purpose of the local government is security and safety, public safety. And that doesn't seem to be happening here. I know it's probably a tough one with the county and the Corps and the ecology department, but how do you folks propose working to get something done down at that river? It needs to be cleaned up now. That's my question.
So we still have the same contact with King County. Jeannie Stukula is still our primary contact person with King County. And the Army Corps, they have changed their head person, but they're still in contact. As a matter of fact, I got an email today that we're setting up a meeting for the river scouting that they'll be doing all winter long. The park is closing up. They've already started, I think today they were supposed to start the process to fill the HESCOs and close the park back up. Now the levee project that King County is working on is they have the right bank is the side they're doing first. And to me, I thought that was kind of crazy that the left bank, which is the city side.
It's the other way around. The left bank is the far side. You look downstairs.
Right. When you're looking downstairs, you're downstairs. Anyway, the left bank. Sorry, I get mixed up. The other side. The left bank is what they're working on first. And they're going through, and basically what they want to do, and I'm not sure if you've seen some of the maps and stuff that they have, is they want that to be the overflow, just kind of the river to kind of naturally find its course over that way until they're able to get to the right bank. And the right bank project isn't slated to start, I believe, until 2017. Now it's fully funded by King County, it's totally in their plan. I also, through Sound Cities Association, I have been appointed to the Flood District Patrol Advisory Committee. So I attend those meetings, and they have quarterly, mostly budget, but we also talk about the project. One of the things that's been really interesting about being on that committee is I've been able to tour the levee projects that they have done in Kent, the three different levee projects that they have along there and along the Green River, to kind of get some ideas when they start planning our right bank-based levee, we're going to have a say on what that looks like. And the HESCOs, because right now, the way the flood district looks at it is they want to take the whole park. Just put where those HESCOs are, that's it. It's going to be a passive place, and then it's no longer going to be a park. That's good, for protecting life and property. Unfortunately, that's a huge part of our park. And I've had conversations with the executive office, and we're going to come to an agreement that we get to be at the table and help designing that. Trust me, I remember what happened in 2009. I was at the senior center all weekend when people were coming in, and we were sending the trucks out to, you know, to start help clean out people's houses. And then the following weekend, I was crawling underneath the houses pulling out that insulation. I remember what it was like. I remember the devastation in people's face and the panic that happened overnight with that water coming in with no warning at all. Never want to see that happen. The HESCOs are ugly. I want them to go away. But I'm more than the people that live around that river to be safe and protected. And so until those levee projects are done, we are working. I'm in constant contact, and I do sit on that committee to have those conversations with King County.
Yeah, Katie, you live in White River Estates, right?
Right. I moved to White River Estates in November 2009. My husband had lived there for, I don't know, 40 years, 100 years.
25,
that's close. And so I missed the flood. I remember seeing it on the news. But one thing that I wanted to mention is to the gentleman in the back is I have a name and a telephone number of someone at King County. I have called them several times over the summer with things that were going on or that I didn't think was being taken care of. And I was really impressed how quickly they did come out and address the issue. So I can, if you'd like, I can get you that phone number. I have it at home. Actually, I think it's in the email. The original people came out and to that garage meeting. Were you at the garage meeting? Yeah. She's no longer there. Katie Vanderpool was her name. She was our general contact. She did move on to a different position with the county. And I think two people have since come and gone. But the one person is very good, and she's very quick. And she doesn't have an answer. She does get back to you on it. So, but yeah, it does frighten me a little bit. I've heard about how the river came through people's back door and raged out through their front door. People lost a lot of things. Took a long time to get their houses back to where they were even deemed to be livable. It was about 7 or 8 months after the fact they had the sandbagging party, and the Boy Scouts came out and we did all the sandbags to try to help shore it up. And then the houses started disappearing. They were sold off one by one or just towards the ground. And in my opinion, they left it. We were told it was going to be a nice grassy place where children could romp and play. Well, I wouldn't let my kids out there for the main fact. There's lots of divots out there, and we have found hypodermic needles and other things in that lovely grassy knoll. But they're doing what they can to get it cleaned up. Yes, it is ugly, but like I said, I would rather have those HESCO bags there if the river were to come up, as opposed to have it in my backyard or in my house. So I'm hoping that within the next couple of years they will have their plan in order and will be able to see some actual action and construction in getting it built up to where we can all maybe enjoy that green grassy area.
I live in White River Estates. Tim Tebow won the national championship. It was an interesting evening. My wife and I decided to go to bed. My neighbor knocked on the door and said, "Did you know that we're flooding?" I looked out front and went, "There's no water, no, we're not." And he said, "Look in your backyard," and that was where the river was coming. I told my wife, "We're staying, we're not leaving. This is our house, we're not going anywhere." And then the water came up through the heating system, and I said, "I think we should go now." We came back the following Sunday, and our neighbors were already cleaning off our driveway and scraping the mud out of our yard for us, and that was part of what we loved about this town. But all of those people are gone because they took their houses, and they left us with a very, very dark neighborhood, a very ugly feel. I wouldn't let my dog play in that field because of the hypodermics and all the other lovely things you find over there. We have neighbors that try to keep it clean. We have neighbors that we try to pick up the crap that people leave behind. But we haven't had a Katie Vanderpool to talk to, and I didn't know there was another person
to go to.
I was at that garage meeting with you, and a lot of promises were made that didn't happen. Still waiting.
So if you were elected council, what'd you do?
I'll be on the Army Corps of Engineers doorstep. I'll be beating down King County's doors. I want my neighborhood back. I want it fixed, and I want it fixed when they promise it will be fixed, which originally was last year.
Okay.
My wife and I remember that flood. Fortunately, we were not, we didn't get wet, but the neighbors did. One thing you've got to remember is the Corps of Engineers admitted they made a mistake. They're trying to correct that now. And the state and the county, the ones behind those corrections, and we basically are at their mercy as went to the side. Another thing you want to keep in mind is, like, coming off the West Hill, we have two roads closed because Mother Nature did her thing. We have no control over certain things, and we have more problems in the city to worry about than what the county and the state is going to do with the river. So take it for what it's worth. I'm for protecting the people, but there's certain things we have no control over at this time.
Well, unfortunately, I can't answer how we're going to get out of the valley. I know that it has been suggested that we have some emergency routes posted, and I don't believe that that suggestion has ever went any place. I think I will bring that back up again and see what we can do without spending $200,000-$300,000 on studies. Studies are kind of driving me nuts. We never get anything done. Sooner take that money and do something with it rather than study. And in answer to Mr. Erlholm, I cannot give you an answer to that, but I'm going to pursue getting you a contact name, and if they're duplicate names, so be it. But I will do my best to get some people's names for you that you can hopefully get some answers.
I kind of have a general question that's a follow-up. We have a public safety director who's supposed to be in charge of plans and stuff, but I haven't seen any plans on the website about public safety in Lahare's. I've heard that the public safety director does work with the Valley Regional Fire Authority. What is your opinion of posting plans and disaster plans? Can we start with the mayor?
I believe the more information, the better. I like to see plans. I think the people of our city deserve to know what's on the agenda, what we're working on. And that's one of the things, unfortunately, the website that we have right now is not real good to work with, and we're working on trying to get some RFPs to get a different website so that it's more user-friendly. But I'm all in favor of having like plans, schedules, ideas, all those kinds of things, and more information that we can share with the citizens and more information that we can also take in from the citizens. That's another one reason why I started and got council to approve doing the monthly or quarterly newsletter, trying to get different information. If you notice, each one of our different departments as well, Public Works Director, Community Development, talking about the things that are going on and things that they are working on,
just trying to get that information out. So, yes, I think those are really good ideas to have, different schedules, different plans, different ideas, especially when it comes to Lahare emergency earthquake. And I guess I had a really good time over at the senior center today. They did the 10-15 shake and rattle, but they had a lot of fun. I got a report on it today. But those are the kinds of things that we need to be working on and constantly updating to is our comprehensive emergency plan.
Well, one of the things that I have seen, I've never been in a natural disaster. Apparently there was an earthquake, a big one back in 1963, but I was one. I don't remember it. But they do say that in something of this, any city you live in, getting in your car, if you're going to be in a parking lot, you should find and have a plan. I think it's called 3-day plan. Is that what it's called, Jane?
3 days, three-way.
3 days, three-way. And 9 times out of 10, you can have the best plan in the world on paper. But once you hit that road, you're going to be parked right behind the next guy, behind the next guy, on foot, and it's uphill. Just like the signs on the side of the road, tsunami evacuation route this way, they don't show a guy in a car, they show a guy running. It's going to be on foot. And elevation is where we got to go. It's great to have a plan, but we have to have backup plans. I don't know what the plan is for the city, and I'm...
On the council?
No, I do not.
Yep, but you're on the council and you don't know.
I am. I'm admitting, I don't know everything. I've never trained to. I am in a learning process. This is new for me. I am on public safety committee, and this is the first time, actually, that this has been brought up. I know that Chief Hawkins has attended emergency management seminars and had education and background in it, and I am going to definitely get on the with him and find out just exactly what his plan is. As far as the website goes, as Leanne says, our website is not very informative, and we are working on that, and states that I'm done, so
I gave you a minute.
That was a 1 minute.
Okay,
1 minute.
Yeah. We're getting restless here, and I'm taking up time. So.
Oh, that's right. So, I don't know what the plan is, and I'm not on council. But the answer I have for your question is absolutely. It's be posted on the website. There's a true Channel 21. If there's a true and absolute plan. Not everybody has a computer. Most of the world seems to now, but we're not that big a town. I've walked all over it.
Not yet.
No. And my wife's rolling her eyes at me. We have to get a plan to everybody. Whether we mail it to them, walk to their door, which isn't as hard to do as people think it is, or put it on a website. Yeah, the plan needs to be posted.
I appreciate all these people that believe in high tech. If everybody remembers the Snoqualmie earthquake, we had no cell phones, no internet, nothing. Everything was shut down. So we need more than just a website or your app on your cell phone or whatever. And you can't call people like me that aren't computer savvy. That's the last thing we look at. And I just check my email and that's about all I do on the computer anymore. So, yes, we do need a plan. What it is, I have no idea myself. We need this plan that's put out there. We need people educated about the plan. And unfortunately, we don't have too many hills in this area to go to higher ground. So you better defend for yourself in a lot of cases. That's all I can say about it. Thank you.
Clint Scott.
Well, unfortunately,
there's only so many routes out of the valley. So without building more roads, I know you don't want to, I don't want to sit here and give you a bunch of political answers, because that's not what you want. But like I stated earlier, I think we need to identify the routes that we do have. But speaking of like when the earthquake we had a few years back, I mean, you talk about what's on the computer and all that stuff. Hey, there was no access to no computers. There was power on. Cell phones, you couldn't get help with anything. I happened to be downtown around. People were jumping, run up over curbs, through parking lots. I mean, they were just nuts trying to get around, backed up and everything else. And they were going no way. All they were doing was running into each other, causing more backups. I mean, it was a real comedy show. And I wish I had better answers, but there aren't any there.
Oh, okay.
I can throw something in about this because I'm on the Auburn School District Committee. I've been on the committee for almost 3 years now, I think. And here it seems the people here are very concerned about the children in their school. And be assured that the school district has been taking this seriously for many years. They have a plan whether if they have the ability to bus kids, depending on what the emergency is. If they have to, they have a plan to hook it out of the town, to get up on the hill, to do whatever needs to happen, whether it's an earthquake or a Lahare or whatever. So there are plans that are in place with some, you know, because they're taking very seriously to protect the kids no matter what situation is. One thing I would suggest is maybe the public service director should start attending those meetings. I'm the only citizen in the whole Auburn School District that comes to these meetings every month. And I have been a local citizen for the last 3 or 4 years, so some involvement on that committee would be great. Meets monthly. And another idea would, as far as for people that do use apps, for instance, maybe an app could be developed by the city that people could load onto their phone, which everybody and every kid has anymore, that they tap that thing that says, here's where you go, here's your path from wherever you are to get out of harm's way in the case of an earthquake or whatever. This is a huge problem. What you're saying about you're going to be walking on the cars, the emergency service director with the city of Auburn is at every meeting, and we've been to the emergency services center in downtown Auburn, the city hall there, and it's true that big enough earthquake, especially if there's a Cascadia, which everybody's heard about, they're doing modeling on that. That would be a huge mess, and we would not be able to count on even crossing a lot of the bridges. Not much less across rivers, just freeway bridges. The cell phones are going to be down, everything's down. You better be prepared. Most people aren't even close to being prepared.
Okay. Thanks, Dwayne. Dwayne's on the park board, too, by the way, and park board's looking for volunteers. Let's take a short break, say 5 minutes, and...
James,
yeah?
Before we do, can I ask Dwayne when they meet and what time and where?
Well, they just start... the committee is actually being enlarged by the district, so it's actually supposed to meet this week, Tuesday, at the bus barn.
So it's Tuesdays at the bus barn, or what time?
Well, it's supposed to be 10 a.m. It's always been really not 10. Because of what happened, some stuff that went on this week, they're rescheduling for November. I can let you know and let Dan know, too, when the next meeting will be, as soon as I find out. Worst case, it's the second week in November on Tuesday. Second Tuesday in November, depending on, I think, what it's going to
be. Gene, may I just say one quick thing regarding emergency management before we get off that topic? So I did confirm with the mayor of Auburn a couple of days ago. I'm not sure if everybody's heard of the Community Emergency Response Team CERT. It's a certification. It's a class that you can go through. And and learn about how to support you and your community in the event of emergency, earthquake. Specific citizens or people from our community are welcome to attend those classes for free at no charge through Auburn. And just you get to sign up for that class so that somebody that lives here resides here at Pacific to take that class. One thing that I learned out of that class, and I've heard this said a few times, cell phones didn't work, and they don't work in the immediate area. And that's what they tell you in that class, have a contact out of state. For all your family members, if something like that happens, you call out of state because you will be able to get outside of the immediate area. And have a contact so all your family members are able to check in so that, and everybody knows they call this person, and this person is going to be able to tell you where your family is.
And in text will actually work better than call.
That's true, too. Anyway, thank you. Sorry.
Okay, no problem. Is everybody good with taking a break?
Yes.
Okay, thanks.